what I have to share with you this morning will be of benefit to all of us. The passage that was read for us from the Gospel of Matthew, the story I'm sure is familiar to all of us. A time of judgment, a time when God will enter history and select those who will live with him for eternity. And those who are not selected to live with him will find themselves in a place where God is not present. All of us want to be successful. We want to have the best of life, the good things of life, and to not only be successful in ourselves, but others to say of us that we are successful. The demand for success is tremendous in the present age in which we live. Everybody is cutting everybody else's throat to make sure that we are successful. We cut corners. We make decisions that are inappropriate. We engage in inappropriate activities because we think that doing these things will enable us to be successful. Everyone is searching for the formula. What is it that will make life successful for me? What is it, the five things, the 10 things that I need to do in order for life to be successful for me? And in these days, books, articles are written about the ways to be successful. And we engage ourselves in buying these books, the 10 secrets of a successful man, the book of 7 secrets of successful living. We buy them, we are engaged with them, movements are formed as we seek out these things that will make us successful. 7 Habits of a Highly Successful, that's the title of the book. 7 Habits of Successful People. All of us want to be successful, so the guy says, I'm holding for me. We listen to testimonies, and we hear people say some things which make them successful Christians. And we ask ourselves, what are the 10 things that we need to do as Christians to be successful Christians? And we bond ourselves to those things. We even change our pattern of living to fit into the 7 successful things that somebody else has said is the thing to do. New norms are created for us. New attitudes are created for us. We sometimes even dress like the people we are trying to copy. We change hairstyle, fashion, because we want to be successful. One of the things that people say to make us successful is the way we dress. So simplicity in dressing is no longer anything. We need to have what I gave this morning, color scheme. You have to dress up in color scheme and think to be successful. The type of shoes we buy is an indication of how successful we are or intend to be. The type of car we drive, the places we live. It is surprising how many persons who have nowhere to live but will not live where they can live because to be successful they must live at a certain place. And we would rather die than live where we can afford to live. Success is important. It's driving us to do and to become what sometimes we don't really want to be and to become. Christians are not immune from the desire and the drive to be successful. All of us seek success and want to be successful. How we read the Bible. Somebody says that to be a successful Christian, for me, reading the Bible every morning at 5 o'clock. And we want to be successful. So we start getting up and reading the Bible at 5 o'clock in the morning. You are dying to sleep. And the Bible drops on our hands. What is it that makes a successful Christian? Coming to Bible study every Wednesday evening or Thursday. But when you come to Bible study, you are tired. And you are sleeping. You are present in body, but not in spirit. What is it that makes us successful Christians? It is singing and not listening to the radio, but singing about the gospel music. And we try to go through life doing these things which we think to make us successful. It's a universal question. It's a universal question. It's a question that is always on our mind. What is it that I am to do to make me a successful person in life? And one of the things that is happening to us in the world in which we now live is that we are trying to contract everything into data. Nobody wants to think through the challenges of life. We want simplistic things, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Shrinking everything into data to make us, so that we can use it to make us successful. Even doctors are having problems these days. And we are reducing illnesses simply to data. So when you are sick, you go to Google. I have so and so. What is the remedy? And Google tells us what it is. And we are more willing to follow Google than to visit the doctor, who has a wider exposure of our symptoms than Google. Data, everything is being reduced to data. So that we can click and boom, solution appears. What is it to be successful? Do this, do that, the other, and you will be successful. Life ain't like that. But for those of us who like one, two, three things, I am going to suggest to us some important things that this passage suggests to us that are important ingredients in our life if we are to be successful Christians. Matthew 25, 31 to 46. It invites us to think of our lives as people of God, little more than saying a creed, little more than saying remembering scripture passages, a little more than consistency in prayer. Our lives need to be characterized by something. This passage serves to remind us of God's way of doing life. One of our challenges is that we see too often, we see life only through our own vision. Not the vision of the Bible, the vision of God. God sees life a little bit differently from us. What is success to us in the present world is not necessarily what God sees as being successful in it. And we need always to bear that in mind. So the rich young man in Matthew comes to Jesus. What must I do? He's already doing something. He's aware. He feels that something is lacking. What must I do so that I can inherit eternal life? What are the things I should be doing? Have you done this? Yes, I did that. Jesus says, sell what you have and come. What is important for him? Most important for him, he can't give it up. Because that is the success he has in life. His wealth, his accumulation of things. That for him, he can't give up to enter the eternal kingdom. Sometimes for us, what we want to be successful escapes us because it is dear to us. The illustration we have in this story suggests to us some things, and I want to share them with you quickly. God's criteria for belonging to the gathered people is demonstrated, is evidenced by our human relationships. Successful living is not what we accumulate, but how we share life with others in the world in which we live. God's criteria for belonging to the gathered people is demonstrated, is evidenced by our human relationships with each other. Jesus separates the sheep from the goat. One group fed, clothed, and visited. The other group ignored and bypassed. Success for God was about relationship. What does Jesus say to us? Hunger and thirst are important matters in life that all of us need to attend to. Enabling each other to survive. Food and drink are basic ingredients of life. And it behoves us, all of us who wish to enter the kingdom of God, to be cognizant, to be aware that there are some people who need help in providing what is necessary for survival. We live in a world in which our interest is but for ourselves. It does not matter to us one iota that we are full and the person sitting next to us is starving. We don't, but that's how the world is, we organize the world. There are some people who are starving. But we'd rather dump the food than give it to persons, to places that are having drunk, that are suffering from all kinds of agricultural calamities. We would rather dump it in the garbage can than give it to a home that is in need. We're approaching Christmas. And at Christmas time, some of us find it to be resolved to have plenty to eat. One of the challenges is that sometimes we eat, we have more than we can manage. And we're full the plate. And we're full the plate. And at the end of the day, we throw more in the garbage pan than we are eating. And we never think that while we are throwing away, there's someone else who has nothing to eat. Survival. Human beings cannot or ought not to live without considering others who need to survive. Water and food. We want to be successful. How can we be successful? By demonstrating our concern for the survival of others in our community. Food and drink. It goes on to say, not only must we consider the survival of others. He talks about treating the stranger, hospitality, and fellowship. The Christian, to be successful, cannot be a person who does not care about strangers. The treatment of strangers in our midst, hospitality, and fellowship. Sometimes we are hostile to people simply because they are different from us. We are hostile. They don't dress like us. They don't speak like us. We are hostile because we think they are a threat to us. And we avoid them at all costs. Even church, strangers come within our midst. How hostile are we? It's a test for us right here, right now, about our lives as Christians. Are we hospitable people to the stranger who comes in our midst? Jesus, in this illustration, indicates to us that one of the successful ways of living is to be hospitable, to be generous, to be a person of fellowship. It's ironic. But in the church, there are some people who are nice people, but they're not fellowshipping people. When the church has things that everybody should come to at the fellowship, they are never there. Always missing in action because we can't afford to mix up with any kind of people. One of the strange things I remember, sharing food is an important thing in life. But we can't share food with some people because we don't think that their food is quite up to standard as well. But when the church has function, everybody must bring something. Some of us bring, but we never take. We bring to give, but they are unwilling to share what others have brought for us to share. Fellowship, hospitality, among us, between us, is important and important ingredient in making success our Christian life. Jesus goes on, not only hunger and thirst for survival, treatment of strangers, hospitality and fellowship. But he also talks about nakedness. What is he talking about? When was I naked and you clothed me? One of the tragedies of modern life is that we treat people's nakedness with disdain. We don't handle the dignity of others very well. Human beings, one of the worst ways we can treat human beings is to not recognize that their dignity. Naked, I need clothing to cover myself. You pass down the other side. Naked, you have more shoes and clothes in the closet than people outside need clothes and things. You throw them in the garbage bin rather than human dignity. We have a way of trampling over each other's dignity as human beings. Use the worst words to describe. Give the worst treatment possible. Over it's one of the hardest things sometimes for people to forgive each other. Trampling upon each other's dignity. One of the places you can see that, I don't know if there are nurses, I've got for that. When people are in need, and you are the person who can help, the worst thing you can do is to stamp on their dignity and work anything and treat them any other. Dignity is an important ingredient in making life successful. Have you ever been destitute? When somebody is destitute and desperate, as in a funeral yesterday, and the story is told of the person who passed on. You saw a woman destitute, in need of care. She was coming from prison, had nothing to eat for days, and without hesitation, rather than throwing her away, brought her in, fed her, and clothed her. Dignity. When last have you and I trampled on somebody's dignity? Fellowship, hospitality, enabling others to survive, handling each other's dignity carefully. Then he goes on to say, you want to be a successful Christian? You need to take care of the sick. Sickness. Nurture and care for those who can't help themselves. As you get older, as the mind numbers are adding up, you learn some things about life. When you're young, I always say this, when you're young, you can't sit. Bones can't break. You're in need of no one's help. And as the numbers add up, you're going to be strong. You need more help. Sometimes you reach a point, you can't do anything for yourself. And somebody needs to take care of you. There are phenomena that's taking place in the world. Young, strong, able-bodied, Christian young people abandon their parents when their parents are too old. Can't deal with the sickness. How often you go to funerals? And those who have gone abroad to live, they will remember that mama needed medicine, medication, and could send a dollar. But make the most noise and cause the most trouble at the funeral. When sickness takes us, we need others of the family, whether the church family or the blood family, to take care. God did not make us to live unto ourselves. We are communal people, and God expects us to take care of each other in moments of adversity. When was I sick and you visited me? God is going to ask us a question. Did we engage in taking care of those who are ill amongst us? God is successful. How are we in taking care of ourselves? Then he goes on. I was in prison and you visited me. What does that mean to us? For me, it's talking about forgiveness. Somebody has committed an error, and the consequence is that person is incarcerated or is punished. When did you visit me? Not putting off the connection, but willing to forgive and restore. Isn't that one of the tragedies of modern human life? We hold people forever for the wrong they have done, even when they demonstrate to us and to themselves that they have repented. But because of what they did, they are unwilling to forgive them. Human beings can't live without forgiveness. Trust me, all of us need to be forgiven at some point in time. We are never perfect. We never know whom we hurt and how deeply we hurt them. And we must not be arrogant to believe that we are above forgiveness. All of us need to be forgiven. So then, you want five things to be a successful Christian? Hunger and thirst, enabling survival. Treatment of strangers, hospitality and fellowship. Nakedness, handling the dignity of each other. Sickness, nurturing and caring for the helpless, those in prison, the willingness to forgive. But why is it that we find it difficult to do these things? I'm going to suggest a couple of things to us today. Challenges to meeting God's criteria. There's always a challenge in that. And the first challenge I considered was blindness. Blindness. We are so focused on what we want to achieve in life that right before us there is need and we can't see. We are blinded to the need of others around us. I want to become. I want to do. And all your energy, your vision is focused on your goal. And right beside you is somebody in need of clothing, in hunger, sick, and you can't see. Blindness. Second thing is insensitivity. You see the person, you see the need, but you are not moved to respond to the need. Third thing, convenience. The tragedy of life is that sometimes when somebody needs help, it's the very moment that you have something to throw that way. And we can't inconvenience ourselves to help somebody else. We can't give up something for the benefit of somebody else who's in need. Somebody's hungry. We can't pause for 5 minutes because we're going to be late for an appointment, which we're going to reach anyway. We could have done it. We can't inconvenience ourselves because it's going to disrupt by COVID. That's a guy in the Samaritan Road. Inconvenience. So help is needed. But I am not going to inconvenience myself by going to church to do anything. I am not going to inconvenience myself by doing this thing on a Saturday. It's my time. Even though the need is desperate. And even though the person is a member of the church, or even though the person is a member of our community, I tell you who I am. I am not inconvenienced myself. Blindness, inconvenience. The last thing I would suggest to us is prejudice. Prejudice. Why won't we help some people? who will help some people that have prejudice. Some people are worse more than others. One of the things that I work, probably with the Americans and the first world people, that their people are more important than everybody else in the world. Justice for them is not the same thing as justice for the rest of us. And we as Christians sometimes fall into that trap. That some people need more, are better off, get our attention more than others because of our purpose. The status, who the person is, where they come from, how they dress, how they look, what they can contribute. We do that. Prejudice. In God's kingdom, there is no place for prejudice. There's no place for acting when things are only convenient to us. There's no place for insensitivity or blindness. We make choices. When the thing is in our interest, we do it. But if God helping us, then I do it. Self-interest. So there are challenges to meeting these five things. Then the story goes on and talks about God asking the people. When the people asking God, Jesus, when did I do these things? When did I not help you and so on? You know what I say this? If we are to demonstrate to the world that we belong to God, we are people of God, helping others is not a publicity program. Jesus said to one group, when you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. They did not even know that they were doing the right thing to God, anything to God. How do I interpret it? Being a Christian, being a faithful servant of God, does not ask us to make public what we do. We help because there's a need. We help not because of the publicity we can get. It's one of the challenges I find in the church. Why is it that we stomp on people's dignity by showing how poor they are and how great the gift that we are giving them? You understand it? Why? A company is not going to give the church any help unless they are take over the pulpit. Have them banners all over the place. Have the thing in the papers. Trampling upon people's dignity. Why is it that some of us within the church not giving as much as we can in time and talent? Because pastors never get upon the pulpit and say, boy, so-and-so gave so-and-so. Church will appreciate what I have done or what I did. God chose people who saw me and did discriminate against who was. They just said, they saw a need and responded. There was no prejudice, selective choosing of who to help. There was no discrimination. My brothers and sisters, we live in a culture that demands 1, 2, 3 things to make life successful. I'm challenging all of us this morning to recognize that God calls us to serve in a way that is different from the world. And out of self-interest. But He calls us into relationship with each other. To take care of each other. We are people of community. He calls us to bind each other's wounds. To take care of each other. That is how God works. So when He comes, He's not going to ask us how much we have. He's going to ask us how many we have. He's not going to ask us who we have. So when the church has ministry, develops ministry, it's not ministry to make the church look good. There are ministries that develop out of need to respond to the human need within our community. Are any of us guilty of being obstacles in the way of church programs that seek to help people? Looking only at our own self-interest? Are we persons who oppose giving help to those who don't even belong to our church? They are strangers, we don't know them where they come from, they don't deserve. But yet they are human beings in need.
my brothers and my sisters. The church binds wounds. The last thing is, if we are people of God who do these things, take care of the hungry, take care of the strangers, take care of the sick, be forgiving of those who make mistakes, isn't there a place for us as church as well to challenge institutions and powers that do the opposite? You and I, as church members, when we read the papers, and we see institutions or persons acting in ways which destroy the dignity of human beings, do we respond? I'll leave you with a thing, with a thought. Some of you may have been thinking about the Alabama case in the United States with Mr. Moore is going to be a signal event. Christians are involved. The choice they make is going to send a signal to the world about us as Christians. Do you think about it? What is more important? The dignity of human beings or self-interest? Amen.
Profound doctrine, sound teaching. And so all the people of God say,